evening, everybody, and welcome to the John F. Kennedy Jr. Forum here at the Institute of Politics at the John F. Kennedy School of Government. My name is Trey Grayson, and I'm the director of the IOP. I want to welcome everybody to tonight's forum. We have a couple of special guests, actually it's more than a couple, several special guests in the audience. I want to begin by welcoming members and spouses of the Council of American Ambassadors who are here for a conference today and tomorrow. We're really excited to have you all here. I want to thank Ambassador Valdez, who's the leader of the ambassadors, for being such a great ambassador and working with us. So we're excited to have you all here. Make sure you ask really tough questions up here to the folks in here behind me. Tonight's moderating or conversation is going to be led by the Jean Kirkpatrick Professor of International Practice, Megan O'Sullivan. Megan was an IOP fellow in the fall of 2007 and was a Deputy National Security Advisor for Iraq and Afghanistan in the Bush administration. We're really pleased to have her on faculty here at the Kennedy School and to lead the conversation tonight. Megan.
Thank you, Trey. And it is my pleasure to welcome you all here tonight. And it is also my great pleasure to introduce Richard Haass to this forum and to each of you. Richard is a man who defies easy categorization. That is, except for one. And that is, he is a world-class scholar practitioner, or practitioner scholar. It's hard to know which one to put first, because you have done both with such distinction. On the scholar side, as you know, Richard is currently president of the Council on Foreign Relations, which is the country's largest membership organization, and it deals with matters of American foreign policy and debate writ large. In a previous scholarly iteration, Richard was a vice president at the Brookings Institution, where he headed up the foreign policy studies section. And if you go even further back into his CV, you will find that Richard had a healthy stint here at the Kennedy School, where he taught for many years on American foreign policy. So in all of these scholarly posts, Richard has been able to make many, many notable contributions, including editing or writing 12 books, 11 of which are on American foreign policy, and one is on management. He has also been a regular contributor to topics as broad as American intervention, Middle East policy, management, sanctions, and grand strategy in general. Now that's the scholar side. On the practitioner side, Richard's career has been equally impressive, with Richard claiming a hand in a lot of the decision-making and execution of some of our country's most critical decisions of the last couple of decades. So most recently, Richard was the director of policy planning during the Bush administration from 2001 until 2003. And there he had a broad remit for planning and strategy across the world, but also, unusually for that post, had two operational roles. The first was he was a coordinator for Afghanistan after the fall of Kandahar. And secondly, he was a special envoy for the Northern Ireland peace process. If you go back even further in his practitioner side, you'll see that Richard was the special assistant to George H.W. Bush and the senior director for Near East and South Asia at the National Security Council. And essentially what that meant is he was the go-to person for pretty much every aspect of the first Gulf War, that is, in its planning stages, in its execution stages, and its wrapping up stages. And if you go even further back into his practitioner side, you'll see that he held all kinds of different responsibilities at the State Department and the Pentagon. So it's this combination of being a scholar and a practitioner that has allowed Richard to make such a unique contribution to American foreign policy, both in terms of the American debate and the practice of it. Without question, I can say that he is one of the most sought after, one of the most thoughtful and constructive commentators today. Now let me say a few things on the personal side, which is to make you nervous. But this is appropriate for this forum. I've spoken with you, with many of you here about how to structure your careers. And often you'll ask me, what are the ways I can increase the chances of having a life that is filled with contemplation and action, which is the life that Richard has led? And always I will say to you, the number one thing is having great mentors. And For all of the things that Richard has done, I hope one that he is proud of is that he has been, to me and possibly to others, a mentor extraordinaire. I don't know where I would be if it weren't for Richard, but I do know that I wouldn't be here and I wouldn't have done the things that have allowed me to make what I consider to be a contribution larger than myself. So over the last decade and a half, Richard, you've been a source of inspiration, of learning, and of fun, and I thank you for that.
Thank you.
And for that reason, I'm particularly proud to bring Richard Haass to our forum tonight.
Thank you, Megan.
So now that I've softened you up, yeah. I get to ask some questions. And I'd like to start actually at 30,000 feet on the issue of grand strategy. You are someone who has spoken about American vulnerabilities and strength. You've spoken about the changing international atmosphere and how that should affect America's role in the world. In the last few years, you've put forward a couple of different possible grand strategies. I have on other occasions accused you of abandoning your old idea of integration in favor of a new idea, restoration. And I'm wondering if you could explain to this audience the difference between the two and why you have moved in favor of a grand strategy of restoration at this moment in time.
I will do all that. But first, let me thank you for an extraordinarily generous introduction, and particularly the last part. You give me more credit than I deserve, but it's actually great being here with Megan, because she is a scholar practitioner. And I think she's actually one of the rising stars of her generation. So it's great to be here with you. It's also wonderful to be back at the Kennedy School. I spent 4 years here in the late 80s. And for me, it was a place where I could pursue foreign policy and international relations, but at the same time, management. And it gets at the whole idea of the intellectual pursuit and then implementation. Indeed, when we used to teach here the basic course that all the MPPs had to take, one of the principal themes is that 90% of life is implementation, which was against the grain because so many smart kids come into the Kennedy School, as I used to remind them, much smarter than me because they got accepted in Harvard and I got rejected at Harvard. And then I would tell them I'm almost over it and not to worry about their grades. And But the importance of implementation is paramount, and it's not enough just to think of the big ideas. And the other thing for me that was so central here was the opportunity to work with two of the giants in the field, Dick Neustadt and Ernie May, and to work with them on the uses of history course. And for me, as someone who's gone in and out of government, I still think their book, Thinking in Time, is as valuable, if not more valuable, than any other book than anyone who is thinking of either going into government or then when you're on the outside about what sort of observations or analyses to offer. And I really think it's the Kennedy School and at its best in many ways. Let me turn to what you said. Let me say one thing about grand strategy and or doctrine, whatever you want to call it. It's important. I actually think that you need one, and a lot of people say it's too tough, the world's too complicated, there's no overarching single challenge like there was with the Nazi Germany or Soviet Union. That to me is not a good enough answer. You need to have some basis for deciding resource decisions. What is it you do? What kind of a military do you build? What sort of foreign aid policy do you carry out? What kind of intelligence do you build, put into place, whatever? Well, it's very hard to do those things if everything's ad hoc, if everything is tactical. What sort of messages do you send to the world, to friends, foes, and those in between? What sort of messages do you send to your own people? What do you prepare them for? To do all of that, absence of structure seems to me far, far harder and far, far less likely, much less likely to succeed. So the argument is not to come up with an artificial construct, and I'm prepared to argue that some constructs are perhaps worse than nothing, but to go out and try to conduct foreign policy day in, day out, absent some sort of an intellectual compass, seems to me to invite inconsistency and to increase the odds dramatically of a lot of bad decisions. Well, I have argued that the best concept for the United States in this era is integration, the idea that in a global world where the defining challenges of the era are essentially global challenges, the flows of stuff, people, viruses, dollars, nuclear materials, what have you, across state lines, tremendous velocity, tremendous volume. That those are the principal challenges of this era, and we can't manage these challenges on our own. No single entity can. You need global involvement, global cooperation or collaboration. And what we ought to do then is bring as many countries and other actors in to the process of trying to deal with these challenges, and where possible, build rules, build arrangements, build institutions. And that's what integration is about. It's essentially lashing together the world with as many partners or participants as you can. And I still think that ought to be the principal lodestar of American foreign policy. The problem is that we're living in a world where very few other countries and others are willing and able to sign up right now. They're preoccupied with domestic issues, where there's simply no consensus. So people may say climate change is an important issue, but there's no consensus on what to do about it. To sort of try to integrate the world to deal with climate change might be a great long-term goal, but it's not going to get you very far this week. So I think you ought to integrate where you can, but you also have to accept reality that you're not going to be able to do a whole lot of it in lots of places. And what I would suggest also is that, particularly at this moment, the United States ought to spend a lot of its time restoring the bases of American power. I worry that these have crumbled, or they're eroding, and we're talking about everything from our economy, which is the most obvious, our debt and deficit, to our growth, but also infrastructure, K-12 education, competitiveness, and so forth. And if we're going to be in a position where we can lead, where we can act, where we can play a large role in integrating the world, I am worried that unless we restore the foundation stones of American power, we're not going to be very well positioned to do that. So while I continue to hold on to the idea of integration as kind of the medium to long-term aim, in the short term, we've got to restore the core elements of our power. And that's where I come out right now on grand doctrine. And in just 30 more seconds, if you think that I'm right, and if you think, say, that restoration or restoring ought to dominate American power, that has real consequences. That means you think twice or three times before, say, what you might call discretionary foreign policy, what I called in another setting, wars of choice. So it has any doctrine, anything, any grand strategy you choose is only worthy of the name if it has consequences.
Push you a little bit on this idea of restoration. Is it just a euphemism for isolationism?
I'm glad you raised that, Professor O'Sullivan. It is not. It is not. And I didn't ask her to raise that, by the way. And even if I had, she wouldn't have. I've learned over the years that Megan rarely does what I ask. isolationism is the willful turning away from the world, even when real interests are at stake. Even when doing so means you are likely to pay an enormous price. Isolationism in the interwar period was in the face of a gathering storm that became the rise of fascism in Europe and Asia. And the United States willfully, essentially closed its eyes to a gathering threat, and the United States and the world paid an enormous price. For those who during the Cold War would have said, oh, the Soviet Union's no threat, it's a status quo power, we don't have to worry about all these things, if we hadn't, say, intervened in Korea in 1950, that would have had real consequences. So isolationism to me is when you make the conscious policy decision, it is, to use your words, a grand strategy, that even when real vital interests of the United States are at stake, we're gonna turn the other way and not act on their behalf. I would say that's a real mistake. What I'm saying is not that. Where we have vital national interests, we should still go out and defend them. And even where we have issues, interests sometimes that are less than vital, we may want to find ways of promoting them other than with military force. What I'm saying, though, is where we don't have vital interests at stake, we ought to really think twice or three times before committing force. And the reason I say this is some of the most expensive foreign policy undertakings of the modern era for the United States have been what? Vietnam, the second Iraq War, what the Afghan War has become. These are all wars of choice. And I am simply saying I don't believe wars of choice, and I think they're always questionable. But in this age, I would actually say they're a form of discretionary foreign policy that, all things being equal, the United States should not undertake. I do not believe that is isolationism, but I do think we have to become much more selective and much more rigorous in what we do and how we do it.
Well, you've taken us to this question of military intervention, and let's come down to 10,000 feet and talk about Libya. A lot of people are heralding what has happened in Libya, and the U.S. role is this new form of limited American intervention, that this is possibly a model for the future. Do you think that this, what we've seen in terms of America being there but not necessarily being out front, is going to be a model for future interventions, perhaps consistent with your concept?
Well, one of the reasons people are saying it's a model is that, quote unquote, it succeeded. And I would simply say the jury's out on that. I would say let's see what Libya looks like 6 months from now, 6 years from now, before people necessarily say that this was a great foreign policy accomplishment. There's been a rush, if you will, to essentially applaud ourselves. And I would just hold back on that a while longer. Your question, though, raises a larger point. Is whatever happens in Libya, ultimately, is it a model of global involvement on the part of the United States, so-called leading from behind? And I would say probably not. I can't think of too many situations where we're going to face sizable challenges abroad where the United States can play a junior role and others are going to be willing and able to step up and play the senior role. If you look at, for example, the trends in defense spending in Europe, which are our principal partners in Libya, the general trends are reduced defense spending, and what money is being spent is not being spent very rationally. If you look at European defense budgets, there's no central authority that's saying, you in Britain spend your money here, and you in France spend your money here, and you in Germany spend your money here. So the whole is an intellectually rigorous whole. Instead, everybody spends it what they spend on what they want. And as a result, the whole is worth a lot less than the sum of its parts, all of which is a windy way of saying, I don't think we're going to have a lot of partners that are going to be able to do sizable things. So I don't think the Libya operation is anything of a model or a template. It was actually quite small, 6 million people, fairly open territory, limited goals, limited uses of force. What we asked of the partners was quite small. I just don't think this is going to be replicable around the world.
I know that you're a person who thinks that consistency in foreign policy is, shall we say, overrated. So I imagine you're not particularly bothered that we're taking a different approach in Syria than we've taken in Libya.
No.
But I think there are plenty of signs to indicate that what might unfold in Syria could be ugly and detrimental to regional interests, the Syrian people, and potentially American interests. What do you think the United States should be doing vis-a-vis Syria now?
It is true, as you suggest, as you charge, that I do not always think consistency is a virtue. In the large part, every situation is different. And it comes back almost to your first question, to insist on consistency, even when the interests are different, the local context is different, you get into trouble. One of the reasons I actually think in certain parts of the world we've gotten into trouble is we've ignored local realities and instead, whether it was fighting quote-unquote communism or promoting democracy in the face of local inconsistency. So I think foreign policy has to have a healthy respect for inconsistency. Now, it makes it more difficult, you're right, to argue why you're doing X as opposed to not doing or in one situation, you're not doing it in another situation. Okay, you've got to explain that. And it might be intellectually or politically easier if you can fall back on consistency, but that will get you into a lot of trouble. In the case of Syria, to intervene in ways, say, that we intervened in Libya, would be militarily, shall we say, ambitious and then some. And it's not quite clear to me that it would necessarily succeed, given everything from the topography of Syria to the population density and distribution. You wouldn't have anything like the same partners from the Arab world or from Europe. And the question of successor outcomes would also be terribly problematic. Mm-hmm. So the answer to that is not that you do nothing. But again, you've got to tailor your policy. So even if you're consistent to some extent on goals, you have to be necessarily inconsistent on means. So I would say in Syria, the answer is not to look the other way, but it is to think about a policy that makes sense for that challenge. And I would think something you've written a lot about, sanctions, mm-hmm. Make a lot of sense. You've got to try to weaken the bases, probably, of Bashar al-Assad's power, which means, in particular, economic sanctions against his bases, which go beyond the Alawite minority, includes a lot of the Sunni economic class. I do think, though, there's a very interesting policy question, and it came up the other day in a conversation I was having with some of the people who work with me. It's a very different policy if your goal is to get Bashar al-Assad out of power than it is if your goal in the first instance is to bring the quote-unquote democracy to Syria. Mm-hmm. Who would you target? What sorts of events would you try to set in train? So I think you've got to think hard about it. And in a lot of these cases, again, you've got to be sure. It comes almost back to Catholic just war doctrine. Before you intervene, and the word intervention shouldn't just be understood to mean with military force, but any form of intervention diplomatically, whether it's sanctions, words, military forces, what have you, you've got to be mindful of what sort of events you're likely to set in motion, how your intervention has changed things, and whether, however bad the status quo is or is likely to be if you don't intervene, you've got to be fairly confident that the alternative status quo you think you're likely to bring about will be preferable. And I would just simply say that when we look at events in the Arab world, however imperfect the situation is politically in a lot of these countries, I would think that we'd better be fairly confident that the transitions as well as the outcomes to the status quo, we believe are highly likely to be preferable if we're going to try to set certain events in motion.
I would argue that you might even say, or not you, but one might say, that you don't just have to do the analysis that the next regime is going to be better, but perhaps there's some element of responsibility for helping shape an environment in which the next government would be superior. And this is one thing I do worry a little bit about in Syria. Let's show everyone we can talk civilly about Iraq. We can't we?
Yes. Of course we can.
Of course we can. As you and I both know very well, the recent Bush administration has understandably been criticized for its lack of post-war planning, for its lack of foresight into what would happen after Saddam was gone, and operating on assumptions that turned out to be very false. And you know this because I talk to you often from the burning buildings in Baghdad when you were still my boss at the policy planning department. Now, the first Bush administration, the H.W. Bush administration, gets credit for a much better executed war, the first Gulf War. But I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit about planning for the post-war phase in that war. What were your expectations about what would happen after Saddam was forced out of Kuwait? And did those expectations meet the realities?
I thought planning for the post-war, the first time around, so now we're looking at 1990-91. And the war, if you recall, ended the end of February 1991. You had 6-7 weeks of air war, 4 days or so of ground war. There was post-war planning done, and I was heavily involved in it in the interagency level. But the post-war planning that was done was heavily informed by an assumption. And one of the things I took away with that is the danger of assumptions. And the assumption that informed a lot of the post-war planning in 1990-91 was that Saddam Hussein would not be able to survive a humiliating defeat on the battlefield. That once he and Iraqi forces were forced out of Kuwait, that we thought it was highly unlikely that his own Sunni generals would essentially turn on him, and you would not have a revolution in Iraq, but you would have a regime change in Iraq where Sunni against generals, again, of some sort, security forces, what have you, would likely get rid of Saddam. So a lot of our thinking was based on that, turned out to be wrong. And one thing I just, in a Kennedy school moment, one of the first things you always ought to say is check your assumptions. Doesn't mean necessarily check them at the door, but check them in the sense of expose them to incredible rigorous questioning every step of the way. Because assumptions will drive analysis to a significant degree, and if the assumptions are loaded, your analysis is probably not going to be worth a whole lot.
For all of my students who are here, I did not say talk about assumptions, but I'm sure you're all nodding. I can see some of it over there.
And think about what happens if your assumptions prove wrong. Again, it gets back, I haven't had the luxury of sitting in on your class on that, but if you go back to some of the stuff again of Neustadt, May, and others,
yep.
A lot of it says, ask yourself, what happens if a driving assumption proves to be incorrect? What sort of analytical or other consequences? And I don't think we did enough of that at that time. We also didn't foresee the twin rebellions coming up and so forth. We didn't foresee the enormous humanitarian contingency in the north. That was done, responded to very in a fairly ad hoc, effective, but ad hoc way. Indeed, the entire planning for the post, if you go back to the, see if I get the numbers right, it was resolution, I think it was 687, the so-called mother of all resolutions, which was the resolution that was negotiated at the UN that would govern post-war Iraq. We were actually thinking at the time, that was probably a 6 months to 1 year. It wasn't seen as something that was going to last for decades. So I think there was an underestimation of the complexity and durability of the quote-unquote Iraqi challenge. So there was a lot of planning done. It just turned out a lot of it didn't match what ultimately became the reality. A lot less planning was done the second time around. And again, there were some powerful assumptions that that infused, shall we say. But also at times there was a willful lack of planning, I thought, the second time around, because people, again, it was based upon assumptions, extraordinarily optimistic assumptions of the dynamics of a liberated Iraq. So one of the lessons I also would take for this is, you know, whatever you do, whatever set of assumptions, have your plan B and your plan B and plan C assumptions, or at least plans prepared as well, just because odds are some of the assumptions in place will probably be proven wrong in the course of the process.
Let me just stay with in the Middle East, and you've spent a lot of your career actually working on what I think used to be known as the Middle East peace process, and I'm not sure exactly how we refer to it now. You've recently written an article for Time magazine saying to President Abbas that you didn't think this approach was actually going to bear any goods for the Palestinians. And today we've learned that the Israelis are willing to accept a new round of negotiations. What would you advise President Abbas, if you were his advisor, what would you tell him to do, particularly in light of the new dynamics with the Arab Spring in the region?
I thought President Abbas made two mistakes over the last couple of weeks. One was in the decision to go to the UN, which at best is a distraction. At worst, if they don't lead to talks, and essentially if he doesn't short-circuit the process at the UN, I believe could lead into various types of retaliations against the Palestinians by the Israelis, by the Americans, and others. The one success in the area over the last couple of years has been the building up from the ground up of important elements of a Palestinian state, a successful economy, successful security forces, and so forth. And I worry that some of that's going to be put in jeopardy. So I thought the entire move to the UN was at best a distraction, at worst counterproductive. Then I worried about his speech. If you actually watched or read the speech that President Abbas gave before the General Assembly, there was not one word in it that I thought would appeal to an Israeli. What it was a speech that was played to the galleries in the hall, and it played to people in the streets of Ramallah. But I thought, and the speech even quoted and referred to Yasser Arafat favorably when Arafat came to the UN and basically told Israelis they had the choice of the olive branch or the gun. To put it gently and diplomatically, because this is a meeting based upon diplomacy, none of that seemed to me to be smart diplomacy. None of that was signaling the Israelis that this was someone you could compromise with. More important, there was not one word I thought in the speech that prepared his own people for compromise. And part of what you do in negotiations is you've got to create a context in which you can do certain things down the road, even if you can't do them immediately. It seemed to me, if anything, he made it tougher. And it's one of the reasons that I think the so-called Arab Spring is going to make the process of moving towards peace in the Middle East, which we all know, God knows, is tough enough, has made it tougher, because it's raised the long-term involvement of Arab publics in the decision-making process, and these publics are going to be less willing to compromise towards Israel than, say, a Hosni Mubarak was, or King Hussein was in Jordan. So the days when Israel could make peace, if you will, coming back to your metaphor, 36,000 feet, those days are over. I think actually one of the lasting consequences of the awakening or upheavals in the Middle East, and I'll much like the phrase Arab Spring, is that you're going to have much greater popular involvement. But that popular involvement will often be populist. Mm-hmm. And I actually think it will make it more more difficult for Arab leaders to compromise towards Israel. So what I would do if I were Mahmoud Abbas is I would cool it on the public rhetoric. I would, as quickly as possible, get back to negotiations, even though he doesn't like what the Israelis have done, because though the Israelis have said they'll go back to negotiations, it's without conditions. But if I were in his shoes, I would not demand all sorts of preconditions. Again, just as an aside, this is about diplomacy. Preconditions tend to be a bad idea. In my experience, too many people involved in the diplomatic business get focused on preconditions, and my mantra is worry less about where you go into a negotiation and more about where you come out. Don't worry so much about preconditions. Get into them. Create dynamics. Do things publicly that change the context. It seems to me the Palestinians are making exactly that mistake. Mm-hmm. By insisting on preconditions that are unlikely to be met, they will never get this process launched. So what I would do is essentially use all that. I would cool it on the preconditions, cool it on the public rhetoric, start. Make sure that the resources continue to flow into the building of a Palestinian state, because no Israeli government will ever leave a Palestinian area again like they did in Lebanon or Gaza without confidence that the infrastructure of a responsible Palestinian partner is there. So he shouldn't do anything to jeopardize the process, if you will, of fayyadism, of state building in the West Bank and Gaza. So those would sort of be my unsolicited pieces of advice. And let me say, and if he did all that, you'd have to still be skeptical about the prospects, given the gap between where Israelis and Palestinians are, given the political dynamics in Israel. And you know, I once wrote a book years ago about the concept of ripeness. And all I would simply say is the preconditions of ripeness are not obviously present in the Middle East. The danger is, with the passage of time, they may become ever less present. This is one of those, you know, some negotiations actually get better if they stew. Whatever the stewing era may have been in the Middle East, it's long since passed. It's overripe, or what I use your metaphor. It's like putting down a good bottle of wine. At some point, it becomes counterproductive. There's a moment to drink the wine. That moment in the Middle East has passed, in a sense. I've really mixed the metaphors here. We're out of control here. So I feel some urgency. But I don't see tremendous opportunity right now, to be honest.
How much of your advice to President Abbas would be based on your experience as the special envoy for the Northern Ireland peace process? That's a peace process which took 40 years to be successful, but now most people, virtually all people, acknowledge that it was a success.
Yeah, but the 40 years thing is not fundamentally different than the Middle East. A lot of what's going on in the Middle East, you can either trace it back to 48 or 67. The geographical divide is 67. And the modern, quote unquote, peace process in the Middle East has been going, since basically the late 70s, if you go back to the Sadat, Begin era. So that's a good 35 years. So it's not that not enough time has passed.
Right.
I would give advice to us first, even before I give advice to him, which is that we ought to spend more time setting the context and not worried so much about what's said across the table. I mean, Hebrew and Arabic both have very good expressions for the English of nothing new under the sun. There's not a lot that's new under the sun in devising formulas for peace between Israelis and Palestinians. You always come back to the same four or five issues, and there's only so many ways to slice and dice it. So what's central as a result to any Middle Eastern peace process is not those ideas. They are painfully familiar. They have been articulated and re-articulated countless times, which is one of the ironies, by the way, that President Obama got in trouble for. But it's a reminder that what matters is less the details than it is the context. So you need to build context in which Palestinians are interested in compromising and feel politically they can survive. You want to increase Israeli incentives to compromise that they feel secure and so forth. So I would be focusing the time on that. And if I were the Palestinians, I would say to myself, what is the single biggest driver of Israeli policy towards us, the Palestinians? Answer would be security. Okay, so I would focus on trying to reassure in that. If I were the Israelis, I'd ask the opposite question. You think about where you can accommodate positions and so forth. So I don't think it's hopeless. but I just think it's extraordinarily difficult. Coming back to Northern Ireland again, one of the, besides what outsiders have to do, which is create the context, in any negotiation, it's not enough to look behind you at maintaining your own domestic position. You've also got to look behind your adversary and ask yourself what he has to do to maintain his domestic position. In a funny sort of way, negotiations only succeed if each side, to some extent, becomes an implicit partner of the other side. And I see precious little of that going on in the Middle East right now.
Let's move to another intractable problem, and that that of, I'm not going to ask you the easy questions, that of Pakistan. I often quote you as saying that Pakistan is the country with which we have the greatest interest and stakes, but the least amount of leverage. Huh. And we've had some new revelations over the last couple of weeks about potential Pakistani complicity and attacks on Americans. What do you make of this? Do we have potential to really build the kinds of partnership that we have aspired to with Pakistan? Or should we be looking at a new approach? And is there an approach that offers a superior outcome?
The short answer is there is no alternative approach that offers a superior outcome. I know it is quintessentially American to see things as problems. And as soon as you've defined something as a problem, your next step is to figure out how to fix it. Maybe because I studied at Oxford, I also see some things not as problems but as conditions. And conditions are not to be fixed, but conditions are to be lived with and managed as best you can. And I would put Pakistan in that class. This is nothing new. I remember my first meeting with Colin Powell when he became Secretary of State, literally in his back office, and we finished a few hours together. And he said, "So, what's going to be the biggest problem?" And I said, "Well, that's easy. It's Pakistan." And I think so. There's nothing new, if you will, about it. And what you said, it is. I mean, it's exactly your way. But I can't think of any other situation where the gap between our influence and our interests is as great. Which is an extraordinarily uncomfortable position to be in. Be that as it may, that's where you are. People use the phrase limited partner with Pakistan. It's a hell of a lot more limited than it is a partner. Let's be blunt about it. Part of it's getting rid of the happy talk. I think successive American administrations have had an approach to Pakistan thinking that if we were only understanding and reasonable and supportive enough, good things would happen. It doesn't work that way. I actually think we do have to go to a much more conditional, if you will, transactional relationship. We also have to accept that even if we are to do that, Pakistan will not do certain things that we want, or will not stop doing certain things that they wish they would. There is some overlap between us, but I wouldn't exaggerate it. And there's some areas where we diverge fundamentally. So we're not even partners by any stretch of the imagination. We're going our own ways. And I actually think, as a result, we have to prepare to both act independently at times, like we did with the bin Laden raid. And there are going to be moments we're going to have to also do some contingency planning for outcomes in Pakistan that could really be awful in terms of terrorism, loss of command and control over nuclear weapons, and so forth. So I see this as on the... It's probably going to be on the list of foreign policy, what's the word, conundrums, challenges, you know, call it what you will, for years, if not decades to come. This is not one that's going away. And the real challenge may be not to solve it, but just be to avert the worst. That may not sound really ambitious, but even modest goals when it comes to Pakistan turn out to be ambitious goals.
Let me finish by asking you a different kind of question. Okay. Some of your most interesting passages in your books are not when you're retelling juicy quotes, and actually you don't do that much of that, but is when you're talking about the dilemmas of being a policymaker, the everyday dilemmas. And a lot of the students here, some of them have talked to me about they're not sure if they could work for an administration with which they don't agree with everything. And I understand that. But I'm wondering if you could maybe remark a little bit on that, because I know you struggled with that, and you know how people can accommodate that into a life of public or in government service.
Well, first off, you would better then plan to become a permanent student. You will never find an administration that with whom you agree on everything. So let me answer in a couple of ways. One is when you're young, it shouldn't matter. I actually think for your younger graduates, when you join administrations early on, like I did at the Pentagon in the late 70s, very rarely are you making high policy. Very rarely. Let's be gentle about it. And what you really want to do at those stages is you want to learn. You want to learn the ropes. This is, you know, I don't know what the meta, this is your internship, your, you know, early residency. You want to do the rounds, you want to learn. And you want to tool up. So you're ready for later on in your career that you hopefully get asked, and if you are asked, you're then ready to perform at higher levels. So I think early on, I always think it's irrelevant who you're working for. I don't care if you're registered Republican, Democrat, Independent. Get the experience, get smarter, get trained. That's what people ought to do.
But watch people.
Yeah, watch good people, watch how they do it. You'll realize that smarts is simply one of the ingredients of success, maybe not the most important. Read the memoirs, read stuff, but don't insist on the perfect job or on the administration that you always wanted. That seems to me, that's really, you want to get started. Now, when you're at more senior levels, yeah, the questions, because you're going to be sitting at the front table more, you are going to have to represent the administration in public. And also, you're in government less for the experience to tool up. You're in government to make a difference at some point in your career. But that comes later on. That comes with middle age and the, or, but you had the experience fairly young.
So you call me middle aged?
No, you had it before middle age. That's what I'm saying. Some of us are required middle age. In your case, it didn't. You were pre-middle age.
Yeah. Stop digging.
Look. You're never, as I said, you're never going to find, you agree all the time. I had two criteria about when to pull the ripcord.
Meaning one, to resign.
To resign. One is when something is so big, so fundamental, that you simply can't look in the mirror in the morning and say, I'm a part of this. And I would simply say those issues, for better or worse, are few and far between. It's very rare that you get an issue of such principle, such black and whiteness, such enormity, that, you know, for some people it may have been the Vietnam War. I remember a couple of people resigned over the Balkans. Cy Vance resigned over the Iran rescue mission. Which, quite honestly, I never understood why that was an issue that rose to that level. For other people, you know, it was other issues. But I would just simply say that's rare. But that could happen. And by the way, this is different from the British idea that you take responsibility and resign. That's not that. We're not talking about British, like when people didn't see the Falklands War coming. We're not talking about resignation out of responsibility. We're talking about resignation out of tremendous discomfort, if you will. Mm-hmm. I just think that's rare. That may never even happen in your career. The other situation is more lots and lots and lots of, it's more like a Seurat painting. It's not one big blob, but it's 50 dots. And you wake up one day and you say, gee, there's 50 dots on this canvas, and I disagree with 48 of them. Why am I here? I'm either not getting my day in court, or I'm getting my day in court and the judge is ruling against me again and again and again. And, you know, I used to call them professional days, where I'd argue for X, I lost the argument if I had my day in court, or the argument, the decision went against me when I didn't have my day in court, but then I had to go out on television and defend the decision, or I got sent over to consult with the allies and others to sell the decision. You can do that for a while, and that comes with the turf. That's part of being professional. But at some point, you've got to ask yourself, are you comfortable? Is it worth it? Do you really think that you're making enough of a difference to justify the discomfort or anguish or frustration that comes from? So I think it's something healthy you think about. I would just think that resignations on principle, whatever you think, are fairly rare. Most people go through their entire careers, and that never even comes up, much less do they decide to do it. And I don't think it's the sort of thing you do lightly, but it is the sort of thing, it should be in the back of your mind. You should always, it's always useful to have an alternative. If for whatever set of reasons, whatever your requirements are for a job, whether it's to learn, and if you're not learning, you say, okay, well, why am I here? Or if you're in a situation where you feel that uncomfortable, and you can't live with yourself or whatever, then okay, but it's the order of stuff you've got to assess. I just think it's fairly rare.
Mm-hmm. And also not to think about these jobs as lifetime professions, that these are moments in time and you're not sure when the end comes.
Right. Look, that could be careers. I mean, lots of people in the Foreign Service, retired Foreign Service, so that's, you could have military, you could have intelligence, you can have Foreign Service. And again, look, in baseball, By the way, this is ball. They still play baseball.
I'm like, we almost gotten through.
I come from a city that they still play baseball. I'm sorry for people here, but if I may use a baseball metaphor, just testing here. It's just diplomacy, right? You get into the Hall of Fame if you succeed only one out of three times. You are considered one of the greatest people ever to suit up. So why go into government and necessarily think you're gonna succeed two out of three times or three out of four times? You're not, probably. Mm-hmm. Well, you may get some of what you want. You almost never get all of what you want, either in the decision or the implementation. So I think you gotta have realistic goals. And you've gotta, over the course of a 20, 30-year career, even if you're not an in-and-outer like you and me, but so even if you're a careerist, you've gotta learn that. You have to learn how to lose. You have to learn how to, you make your argument, you speak truth to power, but not every, you don't go to the mat on every issue. You don't fall on your sword. Otherwise, you're gonna have a lot of holes in you. You're gonna lose a lot of blood if you fall on your sword every time you lose an issue. And you're not gonna play for the long run. So I really think you've gotta prepare to make your case, but it's like in a baseball season, 162 games, no more cheap shots. But you know, you end up in the postseason if you win 90-odd games, which is another way of saying you're gonna lose 70-odd games. You're gonna lose almost as much as you win, and you're still gonna be one of the best teams. And I think in government, you've gotta be prepared for track records, because it's, to me, the most overwhelming thing about government is the constant people stuff. It's exhausting. There's a lot of cooks with a lot of spoons and a lot of pots. And what was so odd about Northern Ireland, Megan and I had a chance to do a lot of that together. One of the very few experiences I've had in government where we were kind of left alone in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm. That was my first experience in government. I thought, this is not so bad.
Exactly. Most experiences in government, though, it's a very crowded kitchen, like most professional kitchens. A lot of chefs, a lot of spoons, whatever. A lot of stuff flying everywhere. And it's messy. Mm-hmm. And it's hot. And it's a lot of struggle, and I think that's just the way it is.
Great. Well, I'd like to open it up to questions from our audience. We have four microphones, and I'll begin over here on my left. And if I could ask everyone just to state your name and your affiliation, if you have one, and to ask a single question without a big, long introduction, that would be great. Yes, please.
My name is Fran Ulmer, and I'm a former IOP fellow. And I am the chair of the U.S. Arctic Research Commission. I would like you to address the Arctic. We haven't talked about many places to the north tonight. So here's my question. The Arctic is warming for a whole variety of reasons, not just climate change, but oil and gas, shipping, et cetera. The Arctic 8 generally are paying attention. So is China, Korea, many other places. But the U.S., not so much. So I wonder if you'd just address the strategic importance of the Arctic.
I can do this. And the reason I can do this is I went to Alaska this summer, and I went to an international conference on the Arctic. One way to think about the Arctic is it's the new emerging market. It's the next frontier in some ways. And along with cyber, those of you looking for careers, probably the two least structured areas of international relations right now, those of you who are into regime theory, the areas where the regimes are the thinnest are probably the cyber area and the Arctic. Though the Arctic has elements of them with the Arctic 8 and this. But I think it's a very interesting area, as you say, correctly, because of the warming. The trade routes are opening up, mineral exploitation, exploration possibilities are opening up. The diplomatic, some elements are in place, but others aren't. The biggest mistake the United States makes, and I expect applause from all you former diplomats in a second, is that we have not ratified the law of the Sea Convention. So when people sit around and they deal with claims to the outer continental shelf, we don't get a seat at the table even though we have economic interests at stake. I find that hard to understand in this age of where energy issues and other issues are so paramount. I do not understand why the United States so constrains itself. I do not think it is a wise situation we are in. But I think so far at least the Arctic is unfolding in a fairly peaceful way it's actually an interesting case study of various kind of overlapping diplomatic arrangements, formal, informal, different constituencies, different numbers of players, and so far, so far not bad. And
public and private.
Public, private, formal, informal, locals, non-locals, mm-hmm. various functional arrangements. And there's still disputes, energy questions, territorial sea questions, fishing questions. And it's truly global. You have countries like China and others now involved in it who are, shall we say, not exactly Arctic countries than themselves. So it's one of those, for those of you who are looking for things to look at where there hasn't been a whole ton of intellectual work done. It actually is a fairly rich area.
Great, thank you. Up in the balcony, actually I'll go with Jade just to be in order.
Hi, my name is Jad. I'm an MPA, second year. You talked about assumptions and the need to question those assumptions. And when Professor O'Sullivan asked you about what would you advise President Abbas, you made a certain proposal, assuming, at least making two assumptions. One, that nothing is new under the sun, more or less, about the proposals and what is possible. And second, that the president did not is prepared to go for compromise eventually, and he did not do what he did not prepare the way back, kind of, in his speech, because we are assuming that he will want to compromise. And so I would like to do the same or answer the same question again, making different assumptions. Those assumptions being one, that the Arab Spring might have made the patience to compromise a lot smaller in the Arab world in general. Second, that the state of mind of the Palestinians inside Palestine might not be necessarily assuming anymore that the two-state solution is the best state solution. There might have been a conclusion that with all those settlements and all this difficult situation, maybe it's a hopeless case, drop it as a possibility. And the third assumption being compatible as well, which is that the Arab world and the Arab awakening have come to the conclusion that Israel exists, it will stay, and there is no anymore, you know, previous ideas floating in the Arab world that, you know, that will disappear, but it will stay. It's fixed. However, what the format of it and the patience of compromise with it
Jake,
is finished.
Jake, can you just make a question there? Or is Those it a question mark?
Three assumptions.
I actually agree with, I'm not sure whether they're assumptions or analytical points. Well, I actually do believe that the so-called Arab Spring has made the task of bringing about peace between Israel and the Palestinians more difficult. I think immature democracies and democratizing countries or polities will have trouble compromising. And I think President Mahmoud Abbas's speech was a reflection of that. I think there is something of a debate within the Palestinian world about alternatives to the so-called two-state solution. So I wasn't making an assumption. I was simply saying the consequence, I think, of going to the UN and the speech he gave will to make whatever the prospects are for a two-state solution, somewhat more distant. And I can't remember your third point, but it slipped my mind here.
But the context of the Arab Spring making compromise more difficult.
Oh, I agree. No, I agree 100%. Yep. That was the first point. And I agree it does make things more difficult. So look, I mean, again, anytime you're involved in a negotiation, and this is true for Israelis and Palestinians or anybody else, your going in position should never be an agreement at any price. Anytime you go into any negotiation, it's always conditional. It's compared to what? It could be it's disagreement compared to this possible agreement compared to no agreement. Some version of the status quo or how you think the status quo is likely to evolve absent agreement. So if you're a Palestinian who thinks that the best you could get through negotiation is not as good as the best you could get through doing nothing because of demographic changes or who knows what, then that's a legitimate strategy. And indeed, I expect that debate will probably become more pronounced in Palestinian polity or polities as moving forward.
Great, thank you. Up in the second balcony.
Hi. Welcome back to the Kennedy School. My name is Rodrigo. I'm a joint MBA, MPA, MIT, Sloan, and Kennedy.
Overeducated, Rodrigo.
We're all overachievers here. Anyway, my question relates to integration and I just never hear very much about Latin America, and especially North America. In 1992, Bush, Mulroney, and Carlos Salinas de Gortari signed NAFTA in 94. It was passed by Congress. That was almost 20 years ago. Yep. The vision of Mexico back then was, you know, is Got this it. The next country in the developed club? Uh-huh. And myopia in both countries has prevented this vision from going on. Mexico is going to become the manufacturing basket of North America and might be a first world country today had that plan actually been executed. How did China play into all of this vision breaking down, and what is it about this vision that never actually materialized?
A couple of things. Well, the reason you don't hear a lot about Latin America is because it's so successful for the most part. It's good news. You mainly hear about places that aren't doing well. But the fact that Latin America is largely democratic, I mean, compare Latin America now to a generation ago, to 25, 30 years ago. Look at how many more countries have moved into fairly stable, predictable democracies. Look at the economic growth rates. Look at the success that is Brazil. Look at the model that is Chile. I mean, Latin America, the relative absence of war. When your biggest problem in Latin America is someone like Chavez, that's a high class, you know, that's a high class region. I think Latin America has done extraordinarily well as a region. The reason it's not more integrated is because of domestic, you know, realities on both sides, some anti-Americanism, but also we have, one of the real failings, I think, of American foreign policy over the last few years is the absence of a dynamic trade policy. We have taken it off the shelf. It's hurt us in Latin America. It's hurt us in Asia tremendously. We have essentially taken ourselves out of one of the principal integrative tools, certainly at the regional, but also at the global level. And it's a trend. The Council of Foreign Relations just sponsored an independent task force led by Andy Card and Tom Daschle, which made, I think, a powerful and persuasive case that we ought to put our trade policy in gear. It's the best development tool we know. It's the best integration tool we know. It's a great job creator of high-quality jobs in this country. So it to me, is unbelievably short-sighted that this administration and this Congress have not made trade policy a priority. So what's happening is Latin America, to some extent, is integrating without us. And you know this probably better than I do with Brazil and several of the other countries. So you're having a kind of a dynamic there. To me, the one problem area in Latin America, and I, second time I've talked about Mexico today, I did it at 6 o'clock this morning, and I'll do it now 12 hours later, is some aspects of Mexico. And some of the fact that the judicial and the law enforcement challenges are more than, in some cases, state authorities can handle, particularly in the northern parts of the country and so forth. So I worry about that. But by and large, I actually think Latin America is one of the, all things being equal, one of the positive stories in the world today.
Thank you. Joel.
Hi, my name is Joel Branald. I'm a graduate school here at Kennedy, and I'm one of Professor O'Sullivan's students. You started off your talk by saying that you're worried about nuclear proliferation. And in that vein, you avoid some of the challenges moving forward. And in that vein, is the administration waiting for a crisis moment to deal with Iran's nuclear challenge? Because from having a look at it, decisions made at times of crisis aren't always the most thought through decisions. And if they're not looking to, how are they trying to, at the moment, if there's still decisions to prevent a nuclear weaponization of Iran, what are they doing to actually pursue that policy?
Well, the policy of this administration and previous administrations on Iran has either been, Megan and I once did a book together called Honey and Vinegar, and there's been a bit of honey and vinegar involved in this. The honey, if you will, has been negotiations and the promise of de-sanctioning, and the vinegar has largely been sanctioning. And that's been the policy to try to discourage Iran from going down the road of giving itself the option to enrich material and build nuclear weapons. It has not succeeded for the most part. It may have slowed it in some places, but also through covert action like the Stuxnets and so forth. But essentially, if you were taking snapshots, Iran has moved closer. I still don't know what the Iranian goal is, whether it's to go all the way or to go 95% of the way there. And that way, they may think they get most of the benefits of a nuclear option without incurring certain costs or risks. My hunch is all this is going to come to a head probably after the American presidential election, somewhere in the next 4 years, whether it's a second Obama term or the first term of whoever the Republican candidate is or what have you. This issue will probably come to the fore, that either the Israelis will say this is now reaching an intolerable point of the amount or level of enrichment, or the director of national intelligence, CIA, will come in and say, we now believe Iran is going to cross this threshold of capability. And if we, whatever chance we have of acting will disappear if we don't act now. And then you'll have to, it's a great Kennedy School case. What are the likely pros and cons, consequences? What do you gain, what do you lose if you act? What is it you gain or lose if you don't act? I think, though, at some point, we shouldn't kid ourselves. We probably will have, if you will, something of a binary choice. And at some point, you end into what is correctly known as a preventive military action. Or you end up with some kind of a management challenge of a near-nuclear, nuclear Iran. I would say each one is extremely costly. This is one of those, you know, Yogi Berra, another baseball metaphor. He once said,
can't stay away.
Sorry, I can't resist myself. I don't know why it is I come to Boston and I keep using baseball metaphors. I apologize.
We're going to send you back to New York in a few minutes.
Exactly. So. Well, the way we're going, we'll probably lose. It's good I won't have to be here next week eating humble pie. He once said, when you reach a fork in the road, take it. And as we're, not original. And I think we're getting, so up to now we've been taking it, because we, but I do think at some point there's likely to be something of a binary choice and a very unattractive choice. Because either one, again, I believe, is an extraordinarily costly outcome, to either use military force against Iran or not to use military force. And I think it will be a far-reaching decision. It will be a war of choice decision. Doesn't mean it's bad. It'll be a war of choice decision because there are alternatives. But for the next, I think most likely for the next administration, again, whether it's second Obama or first something else, but somewhere over the next, you know, five, whatever, plus or minus years, I think this issue is likely to come to a head, and I think it will be quite fateful.
Over here, please.
Thank you very much for the great presentation. You know, my name is Edward Glushenko. I'm a president of the Harvard Club of Ukraine. And I'm going to ask you a question about the Ukraine, obviously. I was recently in Warsaw, where during a meeting with the Lech Walesa, former Polish president, I asked him about his vision for Polish-Ukrainian relations and the future role of Ukraine in the European Union. He was very optimistic, upbeat, and positive. Basically, he said close to, there is no Poland, you know, without Ukraine, there is no European Union without Ukraine. Did he sound over-optimistic to you, and how do you see the role, the future role of Ukraine in the European Union?
A couple of years ago, the question of Ukraine's integration, if you will, in the European Union was high up on the agenda. And the reason it's not was in part because of the debates, for two reasons. One is the political debate within Ukraine, the lack of consensus. And the other is the rumor, when I last left New York, there was some problems going on in the Eurozone. And I'm sure they've all been resolved in the last 2 or 3 hours. And the so the question at the moment of European enlargement and the rest is, shall we say, put off. So at the moment, between, and I'm not up to speed, I apologize, in the internal politics of Ukraine these days. It's been a couple of years since I focused on it. But my own sense, in any case, this is an issue that's been pushed off, again, as much for European reasons as it is. So I just don't. And I think if it's the kind of thing, if Ukraine, if there is consensus in Ukraine that one day it wants to fully integrate into Europe, then the best thing it can do is do things economically and politically that makes itself an appealing, attractive candidate. And given the size of the population, the size of the territory, and the potential importance of Ukraine, I hope it does those things anyhow, whether it ultimately finds itself formally part of Europe or not.
I think we have time for two more questions.
Okay, I'll give shorter answers. I apologize.
No, that's fine. Over here, please.
My name is Kim McCarty. I'm a mid-career here at the Kennedy School, and I've been working for the National Democratic Institute for 15 years, the last five in southern Sudan. I'm wondering if you could comment on U.S. foreign policy towards Sudan and the element of national security that plays into it.
I actually think Sudan's been one of the more interesting cases of how, let me take a step back. When I used to teach here and I used to teach foreign policy, I said, if I only had one word to describe it, I would say foreign policy is hard. Sudan is a really hard case. It was hard case in the specifics, what to do about the North-South crisis, what to do about Darfur. And then what made it kind of difficult on steroids was the fact that you're both going on, and that when you had an agreement on the North-South, it limited what you could do to leverage or pressure on Darfur, because you didn't want to upset. So I just think it's been, and if there were moments for action, they kind of went. So anyhow, we now have number 193, if you will, Southern Sudan. You would know better than I its long-term viability. I'm actually pleasantly surprised things have gotten to this point. If you had asked me a few years ago, would I have thought the vote would have happened? Would I have thought that then would have been peaceful separation and all that? I would have said possible, but unlike, I was wrong. I never thought it would get this far. So the fact that it has reached this point of what's sort of apparent peaceful dissolution, to me is unexpected good news. I'm not enough of an expert, and you would know more than I would about the long-term prospects, the viability and sustainability and stability of this, and whether, even if people have agreed to it in the formal sense, whether there's going to be some burrowing and the rest underneath the surface to undo some of it. So I guess I'm not confident, but again, to me, it's such an interesting case of how tough this business is.
Isn't more attention paid to it? I mean, given there's a humanitarian, do you know why there isn't? Megan, I didn't mean to jump in, but I'm just very curious as to why we keep hearing about Egypt, Syria, Libya, and there's a humanitarian crisis unfolding. 200,000 people are being displaced. People are, more genocide is happening. What's going on that we aren't, it's not in the news?
Yeah, I mean, I think it has gotten a lot of attention, particularly from church groups. I think are probably more involved in Sudan than anything than any other group.
It's the energy perspective, which is energy, comparatively new.
But look, by and large, it's hard for me to admit, foreign policy doesn't get that much attention to begin with. Previous question about Latin America. I mean, this is not a moment where most Americans get up and issue number 1, 2, 3, and 4 is jobs and other stuff. We don't have vital national interests in places like Sudan. I think a lot of these places raise, if it's issues humanitarian or whatever, they're not vital. It doesn't mean we don't have interests, doesn't mean we shouldn't do things, but they are not vital. And I think that further reduces the propensity to pay attention or to do these. American involvement in Africa has always been, whether it was the Cold War, since it was never a principal arena like Latin America of American foreign policy. So for any number of reasons, it ain't on page 1. The media is not there. A lot of it is also, you look at the where people have bureaus, they don't have bureaus in a lot of these places anymore. The mainstream media doesn't cover these things. You look at the nightly news, you look at the morning television shows, the amount of attention and coverage of these issues is minuscule. So it's not, there's nothing unique, if you will, about the Sudan in that it's just worse than some other places.
I'm going to take 2 questions here and then Jessica together and then let you answer both or one.
Okay, I'll answer the
in
one
closing.
That's easier.
Yes.
Good evening, George King with Alcoa, currently studying at the Advanced Management Program here. Our industry has seen the emergence of state-sponsored entities, particularly competing in development projects in emerging markets, and those entities are not bound by the same ethical standards as we are.
What's a state? Can you give me an example of a state-sponsored entity?
For example, Chalco or Chinalco. So, in our industry, what can be done to get these companies to compete by the same standards?
And Jessica, take your question.
Sure. Hi, I'm Jessica Harrison. I'm a dual business school, Kennedy School student. And my question is, as the foreign policy landscape...
How long does that take, by the way? Does that take an extra year?
3 years. A year and a half at each school.
Oh, okay.
Not bad.
There's a couple of us. So my question is, as the foreign policy landscape is evolving, do you think that the next generation of foreign policy leaders will need to possess distinct skills or characteristics from the preceding generations? And if there are distinct skills that they'll need to have to combat future challenges, what are they? And if there aren't different skills, what are the enduring sort of skills or characteristics that they'll need to possess to be effective?
Can I ask you to choose between the two of those in closing?
I'll give you very short on both. On the first, I think what you've highlighted is it goes way beyond those kind of entities. I actually think we're at a moment of international relations where this. A lot of our thinking about a lot of the arrangements, a lot of the rules are state-oriented. And I just simply think that that's lagging behind the reality. I mean, I wrote an article for Foreign Affairs about a year or two ago about, I called it the age of non-polarity. And the whole idea is you now have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of centers of power and decision-making around the world, and less than 200 are states. So whether it's large corporations or Al-Qaeda or NGOs or foundations, I mean, what brought it all to mind is I had this meeting one day at the UN where the Secretary General asked if we would help them come up with a way to deal with global health problems. And I looked around the table, and there were very few people representing states. You had foreign people representing the pharmaceutical industry, the Gates Foundation, and so forth. And I realized that the way we think about a lot of international relations, a lot of the rules are out of date. And the question is, how do you create, to come back to integration, how do you integrate these entities in? How do you give them incentives to do certain kinds of behaviors? How do you build disincentives? I'd simply say, again, a rich intellectual area where the thought and the study is way behind the reality. There's a tremendous lag going on there. And our whole traditional approach of going through the state is inadequate. And we're going to have to think of much more direct regulation. And I just don't think we're there yet. But that's the future. That really is, I think, one of the big things of the next era of international relations. It's one of the reasons it's going to be so complex. The last question, look, I could give you tons of answers about you, but I'm so old-fashioned. And see, I'd still say I want you to know, I guess two things. One is I want people to know history. And so I'm always happy to, Megan was one of the two best young people I had who I hired. The other was a history major from Harvard, who also went to serve with you in Iraq. So
at the NSC.
And at the NSC. So I was a student of Ernie Mays here. So I would, I'm a great believer in history as a background. I also think there's a tremendous, something I mentioned before, to know stuff locally. We get into a lot of trouble when we don't understand local reality, which might mean culture, might mean religion, it might mean whatever. I mean, I think in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, and all that, we pay a price for not understanding local realities. Expertise counts. And so I would want people, you know, to have the local expertise. I would, on top of whatever historical kind of perspective, but I don't think there's anything special that's newfangled. I don't think that what makes you a good analyst or a good practitioner now is fundamentally different than it would have been 10 or 20 or 50 years ago. Some of the realities have changed, some of the technology or instruments have changed, but I still think, you know, what constitutes rigorous analysis, good judgment, effective implementation, those things are pretty much the same. So I don't think the preparation needs to change fundamentally. I worry simply about the lack of it. I mean, this place is great. You've all self-selected to come here, which means that you think about these issues. You know, you're smart enough to get here. I worry that increasingly we're producing a society where people aren't thinking about the world, don't have the knowledge, don't have the skills to compete, all at a time when the world is more important to us than ever. So I worry about this disconnect between the prominence of globalization in our future and increasingly our declining skill set and knowledge set to deal with it. So we're graduating, to the extent we graduate kids from high school and colleges, they're not emerging with the kind of basic knowledge of the world that they're going to need either to act in it effectively or simply to be a citizen or a parent, to make judgments about it, or to be a voter. So I worry that we are failing as a society to prepare ourselves for a 21st century in which global involvement is more important than ever, and we're not meeting the challenge, which is, I think we will pay an enormous price for it if we don't correct that.
Before we close, I want to ask if Ambassador Valdez would like to make a closing comment on behalf of the Council of American Ambassadors.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
Thank you, Professor Solomon. Thank you, Dr. Haas, for an excellent conversation, excellent program. And you covered a lot of ground, and obviously a lot of interest among the audience and all of us. I would just like to say that the Council of American Ambassadors is very pleased to have co-sponsored this event tonight.
with the Institute of Politics, as well as our conference tomorrow morning in Bell Hall on the Arab Spring. And we hope that the students present may be able to join us tomorrow for part or all of the conference. And as I say, it begins at 9 a.m. and extends till 1 p.m. tomorrow. We have 30 former U.S. ambassadors who are members of our council here who will be participating in tomorrow's conference. And tomorrow afternoon, several of us are meeting with a group of students who are interested in careers in diplomacy and international affairs. And we'll try to give you our best advice as to how to proceed with your plans along those lines. Our mission as a council is to help educate the public on important international issues, such as the ones we've been discussing here tonight, but also to help train and prepare young leaders for careers in diplomacy and international affairs. So we're very pleased to be able to hold our conference here at the Kennedy School, which shares our mission in that regard. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow at the conference and those of you who are participating in the roundtable in the afternoon. Again, thank you very much.
Richard, let me just add my thanks to that of Ambassador Valdez for taking us through so many issues and being able to benefit from your expertise and your insight. So thanks for making the trip.
Thank you all.
I know you have a plane to catch, and we'll let you go
back
to the Yankee land.
Back to 30,000 feet, yes.
Thank you again. Yeah. Okay.